How does it feel to be the second tallest artist in this gallery?
Ted Larson's pretty big. You don't find too many guys as big as Ted Larson, so I'm okay with being 6'4".
Are you still trying to grow a little bit to catch up?
I'm shrinking like everybody else. Up the hill from Santa Fe is a large aspen grove. When the aspen leaves turn yellow, we all go up there and hike, and it's beautiful and it's warm. This particular year, there was a big snowstorm before the yellow leaves fell on the ground. So I had a pretty intense experience up there hiking through the aspen grove with the snow on the ground and the yellow leaves that fell on the snow. This painting's called Birchlings. It's clearly related to birch trees, although it's quite abstracted. Way back in my childhood, the birch bark, the way that it peels, it was always really intriguing to me. But this painting was the first in this group of paintings that emerged. This is the wood grain. It's actually painted on a birch panel. The birch wood forms the base layers of this painting. These are all acrylic on wood. At various points in the development of the painting, I will pick up a pencil and just sort of draw a kind of thinking lines, feel my way through the space, and figure out the rhythms and the energy and the possible ways that I can go with the divisions of the spaces. After the painting is finished, I put on a few layers of epoxy resin, which has a high sheen and can be as thick as 1/8 of an inch. It's like pouring a layer of glass over top of the painting. It really makes these clean white areas pop. My concept of abstraction is that I'm usually thinking about a continuum. On one side of a continuum, there might be organic structures, and on the other side of the continuum, there could be geometric structures, and then I'm going to start to merge those together and find a way to orchestrate those different diametrically opposed, opposite aspects. Here are geometric, architectonic, linear divisions that are contrasted with these very organic, fluid, capricious gestural type forms. So I'm always trying to bring together opposite aspects, carefully orchestrate them, not so much towards complete balance, but somehow bring them into a relationship where they can coexist pretty comfortably. I think that the underlying impetus for me is just a really intense fascination for the way things appear in nature. I'm always interested in looking at nature and trying to figure out how things got to look the way they look. And so my painting process has evolved over 40 years out of this fascination for the natural processes that result in the way things look. Geology, for example, erosion. My painting process is almost like the personification of nature, trying to immerse myself in that natural process where I can get a deeper sense of how things evolved. I can bring myself closer to the energies that we live in. Because I think we can delude ourselves into the fact that we're somehow separate from the universe, but in fact we know we're not. So the paintings celebrate the way that we conceive ourselves as being part of the universe. This particular texture here, I refer to as a dendritic growth pattern. You kind of squeeze paint and pull a surface off. If you're walking around in the studio and you tramp on a blob of paint and then you pull your foot up, you'll get this pattern. If you measure the distances between these little raised areas, the ratio of this to this to this to this to this, I mean, there's a Fibonacci kind of spiral sequence there. If you think of that continuum, on one side you have the grid, the other side you have the dendritic growth pattern. One is very organic, one is very geometric. So there again, you're lining up these aspects on a continuum, and then you integrate those disparate elements so that, you know, you wrestle with that a little bit. My paintings break down into different color categories. Many of my paintings are black, white, and sepia. That then starts to become largely about tonal transitions, and of course texture then becomes highlighted. Because the color is played down, the texture becomes more important. And I've been working on the red, black, and tan paintings since I came back from Italy in 1991. There's an awful lot of paintings throughout the history of Italian painting that utilizes red, black, and tan. And in fact, you can take the red, black, and tan color combination, you'll find that all over the Southwest, the American Indians. And why was that? Was because they could readily and easily find those three colors. You can go back to Roman painting, where you'll see a lot of red, black, and tan. You go back to the Greek pottery. If you look through an art history book, you'll see red, black, and tan all over the place. In other paintings, I play the color up. I started out as a landscape painter, used a lot of green when I was young doing landscape paintings, and then I moved into abstraction gradually, and green was a color that got pushed off to the side and I avoided it for a long time. Then I found this particular green and I came back to it, so I've worked with this particular green for the last few years and I've sort of found it to be, you know, really a useful color for me. There's a base color, and that base color, which this lime green, it keeps getting reintroduced over the course of the development of the painting, and then that green gets mutated by subsequent layers of transparent and translucent washes and skims that come over top. So there may be dozens of layers of color on top of this. Well, I grew up on a farm. I grew up with working people. I had every shitty job you could think of. I worked with animals, I raised chicks, I was a Fuller brush salesman, a door-to-door Fuller brush salesman when I was 16 years old. I worked in a bomb factory during the Vietnam War, all night long, night shift, pushing bomb casings down the line. A number of years that I was in college, I was a night watchman, so I was up all night, and then I went to school during the day. I was a school bus driver all through my 20s. You know, it hasn't come easy. I've paid my dues. I've had a lot of really not so pleasant jobs. So I've gotten to the point where now all I do is make art, and it's, I really appreciate it. I've been getting together with some old friends here in Philadelphia, and we've been talking about our lives, and I find myself more and more in a state of grace or gratitude, and I'm just, yeah, it's really good. It's great to be able to create things all day long, every day. It's the greatest antidote to depression or despair, which has no effect on me anymore, because I have every day, all day long, to make things. I'm lucky, and I'm grateful that I can spend every day just putzing around making stuff.
Right now, the other thing is, how does it feel to have a YouTube video with 179,000 hits?
That's pretty boggling. I mean, I just don't understand how that happened. It's like the expanding universe at a faster and faster pace just gets more and more all the time. I don't know who's out there doing it.
But in that particular video, I think just whistling. Okay. It's like something out of a Jimmy Stewart movie.
Yeah, I'm happily working with it. Yep, happy working with it.
Any tips for me?
Tips for you?
In terms of getting 179,000 hits.
You know, people like to see the way things are done. They really like to see how things are done.
Okay, pretend to paint.
Pretend to paint.
Is that pretty much how you do it?
Yeah, I'm pulling things across the surface.
Okay.
I'm pulling paint across the surface.
Now that tip ought to be worth at least 60,000 hits.